The first concept is trend lines. The second concept is channels. Let's dive right in. One of the simplest and most effective tools in the entire world of technical analysis is that of trend lines. Our brains attempt to find patterns out of random noise. You may have even played a brain teaser where it asks you which line is longer, or even if two lines are connected when they really aren't. Either way, the concept of trend lines is instinctive. You may have already noticed how the support and resistance swings may line up in an upward or downward sloping line. This is a trend line. It is one of the simplest but most effective tools employed by technical analysts and chartists. Let's take an example in Sketch, then one in the live market, and we'll conclude by showing you how to properly draw trend lines before moving on to the concept of channels. If you can draw a trend line, drawing a channel line is a minor extension, but it is important that you know how to properly draw a trend line. Otherwise, it won't be as impactful to your trading, and you'll end up chasing patterns your brain tells you exist, but that really do not. Our sketches of trend lines are simple enough. The first is an uptrend. Our trend line is drawn to the obvious swings at 2 and 4, which are support areas for price. It's important to note that the size of swings 2 and 4 are approximately the same size. If you remember, in the real market, there are major, intermediate, and minor trends. We don't want to use a major trend and a minor trend to develop a trend line because the magnitude of those changes are just so very different. We'll see this in live examples. The downtrend is the exact opposite of the uptrend. The same principle of using approximately the same swing applies. But in this case, we're focused on areas of resistance to draw our trend line. Simple, right? Let's look it out in the live market. Well, here it is. A very recent example from the E-mini S&P 500. The time frame from the chart is hourly, and it is a snapshot of market action at the time of making this lesson from September to mid-October. I do want to emphasize this. The charts in this course aren't cherry-picked to demonstrate a point. These charts are as the market is unfolding, similar to what you'll encounter if you decide to trade. You can't trade yesterday's price action. You have to trade the hard right edge of the chart. You have to trade the now. So that's what we like to demonstrate in these lessons. We like to use the current market action. We've gone ahead and labeled the swings for you to more easily visualize, and you can see that there are many. The blue line is our upward sloping trend line, and you can see it's actually quite well behaved. Believe it or not, the only work we did was to connect swing 2 to swing 4 and extend the line. Swing 2 and swing 4 were the two points used to create the slope. This is an important point in drawing trend lines if you're going to use them in technical analysis, and it's the first rule in drawing trend lines. Use two consecutive swings. What can we conclude about the swing size from areas 1 and 2 and 3 and 4? Yes, you're correct. They are about the same. In the sketches, we said this was a key part of drawing a proper trend line. If you notice, between swings 3 and 4, there is a minor trend that would have been tempting to use as a swing point. And in real time, you may have even used it. But as trading developed, it would have been apparent that it was only a minor trend in the intermediate move from swing 3 to swing 4. And this is the second rule of drawing trend lines properly. In defining consecutive swings, they need to be approximately the same magnitude. How about another example? Well, I'm glad you asked. Here's a second example to solidify the two rules of trend lines that we just established. Our market this time is crude oil. It's a 30-minute chart taken from the beginning of October to the current date of 20 October 2016. You can see we've labeled the swings for you in red, and there are 6 total. Looking at a naked chart without any labeling, you may wonder if you could even discern a trend in this action. The zone certainly appears to be a consolidation zone, but the giveaway is the successfully higher lows of each swing. Once we labeled our swings, we can search for two things that meet our rule. Those rules are 1, that the swings are successive, and 2, that the swings are about the same magnitude. The areas at 2 and 4 meet those criteria, and we draw the trend line in blue. Something interesting, though, happens between the action at swing 4 and the action at swing 5. Do you see it? Price spikes down, penetrating the trend line, but then continues on essentially in the same trajectory that it had. This is usually significant, and the more you watch market action and charts, you'll develop an eye for these types of things. To account for this, we draw the green dashed line connecting swing 2 and the spike, and then extend the line. But we also leave the blue trend line in place, as that is our primary trend. You can see the intermediate swings between 5 and 6, and the first intermediate swing after 0.6 are well behaved and generally respect that area of support. Similarly to 0.6, price absolutely respects that area of support, and you can see what happens to the price action after that. It makes a big move higher. To emphasize the important part of this, the two rules of trendline are as follows. 1. Trendlines are drawn between successive swings, and 2. Swings chosen should be approximately the same magnitude. Why do we do this? Why not just try to capture all of the price action we see on a chart and throw up a line? The key to this is, if we're going to use trendlines as a tool and take advantage of the psychology at play in the markets, we can't use random actions to determine outcomes. We need to be consistent in our behavior and judge market outcomes through the lens of consistency. These two rules give you that consistency in behavior. If you recall in the last lesson on trends, we showed a cartoon that demonstrated the psychology of marketplace in the early period of trend formation. Once price pulled back to the zone of consolidation in that example, some of our market participants changed their position. Others added to their position, while others reversed their position, but not all. Imagine this happening over millions and millions of market participants. Some are early to the market action. Others, as in our example, may be late. Phil is the perfect example. Even though the market pulled back to the zone of consolidation, he held on to his short. Maybe because he thought price was going to reverse. It didn't. So now he really wants out. But he may try to wait for the next logical place. Keep in mind, there are going to be millions of fills in the market. That next logical place to get out would be at the trend line, and so the behavior repeats itself. If it doesn't repeat itself, then it's not the trend line that was drawn that was wrong. It's the market doing something other than we thought it would. And it's better to observe the market for what it's telling us than to try to make it conform to some preconceived notion of how it should be acting. Remember, just because the market is doing something we don't think it should is great information, and it's an opportunity to check our own biases and assumptions. So those are trend lines and how to draw. Let's move on to the concept of channels. Same drill. We'll look at some sketches, then move over to live market examples. To draw channels, we start with the proper drawing of the trend line, following our two rules. Once that's drawn, we simply copy the same line, which has the same slope. No manipulation, just copy it. But where then on the chart do you put it? The answer is at the intervening peak between the troughs that you chose to draw the trend line with. The downward trending channel is drawn the same exact way, but using the intervening trough as the point to connect the channel line. Same as with the uptrend, we begin by drawing the trend line following the rules we just established. Copy the line and connect it to the intervening trough. Let's move over to the live market example and see how this plays out. We'll use the same charts as before because we've already seen how we developed the trend lines in those examples. Look familiar? Yep, it's the same example as before in the E-mini S&P 500. Only now we've added our channel boundary as the green dashed line. Remember how we got here. We first drew the blue trend line between swings 2 and 4. This was on purpose because the swing size between 1 and 2 was about the same as that between 3 and 4, and swings 2 and 4 were consecutive. Following our rules for channels, we simply copied that line and placed it at the intervening swing, which in this case was swing 3. You may say to yourself, well, that's great, but look at swings 5, 7, and 9. The price action at those swings isn't captured by the channel we drew. That's okay. The purpose of the channel isn't to capture all of the market action. The purpose of the channel is to plot what is psychologically meaningful and evaluate why price is or is not congruent with our expectations. There could have been a news event at swing 5 or a geopolitical event at swing 7. It is interesting to see that, though, that swings 5, 7, and 9 are closer and closer to the channel boundary, and that each time price swings up through the channel, it quickly returns to the lower boundary of that channel, our trend line. Let's bring back our crude oil example and see how that fares. In the crude oil example, we drew a primary trend line between swings 2 and 4. Following our channel rules, we used the swing at point 3 to land the copied trend line. As you can see, the swing at point 7 is beginning to approach our channel boundary, and we would expect a reaction in price once that boundary was reached. Do recall in this example we drew in a secondary trend line using the price spike between points 4 and 5, which coincided nicely with the swing at point 6. We don't use this line for the purpose of plotting the channel boundary because this is our secondary or minor trend. So let's sum this all up. We covered both trend lines and channels in this lesson. You learned that to properly draw a trend line, you use two consecutive swings that are of approximately the same magnitude. You also learned that to complete the picture using a channel boundary line, that channel boundary is created using the same line of the same slope as the trend line connected to the intervening swing. And there you have it. You're now well on your way to being a chartist. Go ahead, pull up some charts of your own and experiment with this. I've included a couple of unmarked charts in the example section with a suggested markup for you to compare with. Remember, this is subjective work, so there's no exact right answer, but there are ways to be consistent, and that's what we're attempting to teach you. Try the exercise,